Here we go. All right, guys. One, two, three, and. Well, good morning to you. Let's all stand together and lift our voices in praise and sing a couple of carols together. Good morning to you. Welcome to worship. We're glad you're here. Sing this.
Joy to the world, the Lord is.
give a hand to the Lord today. Celebrate Him together. As we celebrate lighting our third Advent candle. So Jason, if you'll lead us. Guys, there it is. Thank you.
Oh, send out your light and your truth. Let them lead me. Let them bring me to your holy hill and your tabernacle. Then I will go to the altar of my God, to God my exceeding joy, and I will praise you with the harp, O God, my God. Please join me in responsive reading. It's getting closer.
We feel it.
These days are shorter, but the lights burn brighter.
We're listening. We're eager to hear good news.
We've gathered in the house of God.
We're here to praise Him with our voices.
We're here to praise God with beautiful music. Today, we light the candle of joy.
We worship God with exceeding joy.
Go for it.
Sing this together.
Joyful all ye nations, rise. Join the triumph of the to
Father in heaven, we rejoice today and we thank you that you are the giver of joy. As you just read, we come to you with all we have. We worship you with our voices. We worship you in song. We pray that we'll worship you with our actions and even with our thoughts. Lord, you deserve all good and great things, for you are the giver of all good and great gifts. And we thank you that because of you, we can have joy regardless of the circumstances or the situations or the storms that come in our life. Lord, we have some this morning who are grieving and who need you to share with them joy and a peace that passes all understanding. So today we pray that you will supply that in abundance according to your riches and glory. We lift up the Mitchells and we thank you so much for that family. We thank you for the registers and for Miss Delva. And we thank you that this week, Robin and Miss Delva heard, "Well done, thy good and faithful servant." Lord, for both have ministered to so many people and have seen lives transformed because of the goodness and grace of Jesus, which they exemplified in their words, in their actions, in their homes. So we thank you, Lord, for them and pray for the ones that are still here. Lord, that they will carry on those legacies and make a difference in their families and in their future homes. So the same things could be said of them, which we have recently said about Robin and Miss Delva. Lord, we thank you for our program that has lifted you up last night and will lift you up again tonight. And we pray, Lord, that people have been invited, will remember and will come. There'll be no limitations or distractions that will keep them from their place in hearing the gospel and singing praises to you. We thank you for the young girl who said yes to you last night, maybe others, but we thank you for Tinley. And we pray, Lord, for those that'll be here tonight, that they will also have their eyes opened if they're currently living in darkness, bound to sin. Tonight will be the night of freedom and release and relief and joy and a new eternity. So, Lord, we thank you for that. Lord, we pray for the Slades and for Mallory, for Rhett. We pray, Lord, for their health, that you will bring them back to full health. And just thank you for the gift of life. Thank you for our families, Lord. You've given us some incredible, incredible families here. As we've just seen one today, a newer family that helped to lead us in, Lord, this Advent season. Thank you for those that you're bringing here. Thank you for those who are still to come. And thank you for those who have been here for decades and decades. We pray that you will do a great work in us and through us today as we focus on the family. Thank you for being the head of it. We pray that you'll continue to lead us as a church family to follow you in grace and in truth. And we ask this in Jesus' name.
Thank you. And thank you, choir. If they were a blessing to you last night, would you give them a hand? It was a great program last night. Thank you so much for your ministry. If you didn't get to hear it last night, you don't want to miss it tonight. We had a precious 9-year-old girl excitingly come to me after the program and tell me how she accepted Christ last night with one of our guests who invited her. So I just want to remind you, it's one of the times of the year that people are open and they invite your friends and your neighbors and your enemies and anybody else tonight. It's going to be a great time. It really is a great opportunity of worship, much participation. So I hope you'll make it a priority and be here tonight. We had a challenging celebration time yesterday. How many of you know you can do both? Celebrate a life gone and be very challenging, because Robin Mitchell, 45 years of age, is now in the presence of Jesus, leaving 8 children behind, called Dalen this morning and told him we were praying for them. When I talked to Eugene Cherry earlier in the week, we had over $400 of food already for them, and they need our prayers. Incredibly godly family that is doing it the Lord's way, but I know if you're like me, it's hard to even put yourself in that position, so I know they would very much appreciate you praying for them and continuing to uplift them. One of our real saints in this body, Delva Register, all of 93 years young, went home to be with her Savior Saturday morning. Next Saturday will be her celebration service. I think it's 10 o'clock, visitation 11 o'clock celebration, and I know you'll want to get that on your calendar, invite people to it. If you are a guest here today, we welcome you. We pray you sense the love of God's people, and you will be ministered to by the Lord today. Please take this card out in front of you. Fill it out. If you're local, we have a gift that we'd love to get to you. It'll beat you home many times. On the back side of that card is a prayer request card. Last night, I asked people to turn in prayer requests for people that they're inviting tonight that do not know the Lord, and had the privilege, Tammy and I, of praying for those last night. If you would do that this morning, turn those in. We will pray for them this afternoon and look forward to seeing what God has to say tonight and what He wants to do. Now, some of you have never taken the opportunity. I remember C.W. and Betty. It's nice to have you back, C.W., along with Jordan and a number of people. But I remember a number of years ago, I began to talk about Christmas Eve service. I love Christmas Eve services because they are celebrating the one whose birthday it is the next day. And if we can't celebrate Jesus' birthday on Jesus' birthday, something's wrong. But we try to be sensitive to that because people have all kinds of wonderful family traditions that take place that night, and I understand that. And I challenge people every year to make it part of your family tradition. We really are time sensitive. We come at 5 o'clock. We're out of here by 6. But it is an incredibly meaningful time of making sure Christ is central. And Miss Betty came to me and apologized profusely that they weren't going to be able to be here because they have this giant, and they do, about 100 people usually get together, and we have become part of that adopted family on Christmas Eve. But CW told me, I'm coming anyway. And he did. So Betty and them have been here and made it part of their tradition. I encourage you to do the same. We really have a wonderful time. Everywhere I've been, I have been told, don't do it, it won't work here. Everywhere I've been, we've done it, and it works just fine. Because here's what happens, folks. There's a number of people who are looking for that opportunity. And we have large groups that are guests here that come in worship. We will take the Lord's Supper together. We will celebrate together. 3 years ago, and I talked about it last night, sitting about where John Brightwell is, a lady named Kathy was there. And she came in. She's a mature lady. Nice way of saying she's old. And she was. And she sat about right there. And with the lighting being what it is, I couldn't see everybody, but I noticed her because she was intent that Christmas Eve, and right before we take the Lord's Supper, I talk about it being the Lord's Supper, and it's for God's children. And if you don't know the Lord, you can change that right now. And you can recognize your need of a Savior who died for you and shed His perfect blood for you and rose again, giving you victory over death. And if you recognize Jesus as the only way to salvation, you can't get there yourself, I encourage you to respond to the grace of God. And Kathy was already weeping by that time, and she hadn't been in church much, and she just walked out and came and stood right here while I'm talking. She wanted Jesus. So I said, "Tammy, I think this lady is really serious about wanting Christ in her life." And Tammy had the privilege of taking her out and leading her to Christ. And every Christmas, I'm reminded of that. And just by God's grace and God's providence, a couple weeks ago, I got a text from her. She moved out to the Midwest in a very small, cold town in the sense of weather. But she said, "Pastor, I just want you to know I'm in love with Jesus more than I've ever been. I'm serving using my gifts and talents in this little church. Still very thankful for what Christ has done in my life." She got involved with our Faith Writers class. And I just want to remind you folks, it's like taking candy from a candy store when you invite people out to a Christmas program. They'll come. Won't come any other time sometimes, but they'll come. I had a friend I played racquetball with. He was looking for fulfillment in all the wrong places. His name was Will. Cussed like a sailor on steroids. Was a womanizer and just a mess. And I began to invite him to our Christmas program. And my racquetball buddy said, "You're wasting your time. You're crazy if you think Will's ever going to step inside of a church building." I said, "Hey, God's a lot bigger than you are." And I heard that day, because the church had been praying, the very back row, Will sitting back there, ducking down because he knows me and he knows all. He's gonna call me out if he knows I'm here. But Will came that day and heard the gospel. Listen, there's people all around you that need Christ. Just takes a phone call. So I encourage you to make that call. Kathy came, got saved on Christmas Eve. What a great Christmas Eve service. 5 to 6. You don't want to miss it. And then December the 22nd, we're going to have our fifth Sunday on the fourth Sunday where we sing carols together and have some special things. But on our Christmas Eve service, we always have an opportunity to give gifts to Jesus. What do you give someone who made it all? What can you possibly, he owns it all anyway, but here's what Jesus said. When you minister to the least of these, you've given unto me. So during this Christmas season, we're going to give in two different ways, really the same thing, but the leading in which God leads you. We're going to have an opportunity to give to our benevolence fund, which helps people that are much more needy than most of us in here. And we will have envelopes. Miss Betty's going to make sure we have plenty. If you want it going to benevolence, you'll just mark it benevolence, and it'll go into that for ministering to people in great need. If you want it going to the Lottie Moon offering, which ministers in a broader way to people that need Christ across this world, then you will mark it that way. Our goal this year is $18,000. But that's what we'll be giving to on Christmas Eve. So I encourage you to come and be prepared for that. We're really looking forward to that time together. Now, with all of that said, how many of you were able to be here last night? Would you raise your hand? Would you look at the people next to you and say, "It's worth it. It's worth it. Come." What are you laughing about? Oh, well, I'm glad. No, some of you weren't here. I know a couple of wasn't here. Right there. Hopefully he'll be here tonight. That little guy right there. If you were here, would you look around and say, "Hey, it's worth coming. I promise you it is. Come tonight, it's worth coming." Go ahead, no one's saying that. Go ahead, look at people, say, "Hey, you need to be here tonight, it's worth coming to."
Need to be here.
That's right. You guys tell them. You want them to come, yeah. So we're looking forward to tonight. If you're a guest here tonight, if you're a guest here this morning, I hope you'll feel welcome to come. It starts at 6 o'clock. for whatever reason, I think it's the way Satan works, we keep having people that find it listed as 7:30. We've tried everywhere to find how we can get that off there. We can't even find where it says that, but another lady showed us last night. So it is 6 o'clock tonight, and we hope you'll be here. If you're a family member here today, and by the way, I know you don't know that we have a family member in here, part of our forever family, that has a zoo at their house. Does anybody know who that is? They read to you this morning. Come ask them about the zoo at their house. You think I'm being not literal. It's a literal zoo. Great place to see. They have ministry plans for that later in life, but come talk to them about that this morning. If you're a family member today, would you stand and find somebody? Now, wait before you do that. If you're a guest, stay seated because we want to greet you. Greet each other in the name of the Lord. Thank you. All right, if you would find your way back to your seats. Miss Savannah, would you come forward, please? It's always a blessing to see people that are using their gifts and talents for the Lord, but I sat right there and was blessed to see Savannah minister in music. Are you 12 or 13? 12 years old. She is the least... the youngest aged person in our choir right now, and I encourage you to come see her worship the Lord tonight. It was a blessing. Give her a hand. Tell your mama she can pay me now for what she asked. She really didn't ask that, but give Savannah a hand. We're really glad that she did that. Listen, there's a little bit for everybody. The children actually come younger than Savannah, take part of the program, and they were a blessing, and we're looking forward to seeing the way that God uses it tonight. Take out your bulletins, if you will, for some important announcements. Pastor Dave. Good morning.
And it's great to see you all this morning. Just another reminder, Pastor Rob mentioned it multiple times, but our Carols of Christmas this evening. And again, just making sure everyone understands it's at 6 o'clock. So quiz time. What time is it tonight? Okay. How many of you are inviting someone? Okay, more hands, okay. So just make sure, take advantage of that. It was a precious privilege last night to see young Tinley raise her hand boldly and to come find Pastor Rob immediately after the service, and she was so excited. You know someone like that with that same need. So just want to encourage you to take advantage of that. What time again tonight? Anybody remember? Thank you, okay. So just remember, those of you going to Guatemala, we're so excited for our Guatemala missions team going in March. We have 29 people from our church going to Guatemala this March. Awesome team, and awesome, it will be an amazing trip. There's a note with a payment deadline in there, and so just take note of that. It's in the center section of your bulletin. So please pay attention to that, and if you need to make any arrangements or any contact with that, please see Pastor Kevin, and he will be able to answer any questions or work with you on that. Additionally, this Wednesday night, each year our children's ministry on Wednesday night goes caroling, and they go to people who are shut-ins and people who are at home, not able to get out to hear the carols of Christmas, not able to get out to a service. Our children go to them, and it's a really neat opportunity. And so parents of kindergarten through fifth graders, pay attention to that note on the right side in the children's ministry section of your bulletin. Don't forget there's a waiver that's required so they can go. And so just make sure that's taken care of as well. And so there's a few other announcements in your bulletin. As Pastor Rob mentioned, the Lottie Moon offering will be is going on. We have that goal. Another way you can contribute to that and be part of that is we have the mailboxes out back for Christmas cards, and that's an opportunity for you, rather than church family members putting a card in the mail and paying that to the postal service, you can take that same postage you would have used and put it in a Lottie Moon offering. And also, by way of reminder, most of you know the letter your last name starts with. If you go out there and pull out that box and go through it, there may be a card in there for you. So each year we end up with several cards people have brought for you, and you forgot to pick them up. So just be checking that box and for those cards in there. At this time, we'll turn our attention to prayer with Chris Moyer for our offering.
Please pray with me. O most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you today. We're just thankful to be in your house. Lord, we thank you for this time of year, for the Christmas season, what it really means. Lord, I just thank you for some of the examples that we've seen of your faithfulness and your love, Lord. Lord, I was at the service yesterday with Miss Robin Mitchell, Lord, and to be able to see four of her family members get up and in strong faith and boldness speak about you and the life that Miss Robin carried. Lord, I pray that each one of us would have that reputation and that character and that boldness to be able to do that, Lord. Lord, I pray that you'd be with the Mitchells and with Miss Delva's family. Lord, I pray that you'd be with both those families this week. Lord, as I know this time of the year is going to be difficult. Lord, I pray that as a church family, we would lift them up. Lord, that we would wrap our arms around them and let them know that they are loved and they are cared for. Lord, I pray that you would use this tithes and this offerings in only a way that you can. Lord, we love you and thank you for what you're going to do in this place. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
She laid him in a manger. Good news, the Savior is born this day. Like the angel said it, she named the baby Jesus.
He came to free us and to make a way. Wonderful Counselor, Everlasting Father,
the prayer.
baby and she laid him in a manger. Good news, the Savior is born this day.
But the angel said she named the baby Jesus.
He came to free us and to make a way. Wonderful Counselor, Everlasting Father, with the shepherds we proclaim. Mary had a baby that the whole world given the praise. Tell it to your neighbor, tell it to your friend. All around the world, the story never ends. Tell about a baby, tell him why he came. Came to bring salvation, Jesus is his name. Tell it to your neighbor, tell it to your friend. All around the world, the story never ends. Tell about a baby, tell him why he came. Came to bring salvation, Jesus is his name. Go tell it on the mountain. Mary had a baby and she laid him in a manger. Good news, the Savior is born this day.
But the angel said, name the man in Jesus.
He came to free us and to make a way. Wonderful Counselor, Everlasting Father, with the shepherds we proclaim. Mary had a baby that the whole world given the praise. Mary had a baby that the whole world given the praise. Given the praise.
So you don't want to miss it tonight. Be here. We'll look forward to seeing you. Take out your Bibles, please. Thank you, choir. Take out your Bibles and turn to the book of Mark as we continue going through this wonderful gospel written to the Romans. Gentiles, thank God that the gospel is relevant for not just the Jews, but the Gentiles. Please continue to pray for Louisa Thomas. For you who don't know, she needs our prayers. She is not here again today, is not feeling well, and really is having some health challenges that needs the Lord's intervention. Also, Scott Mock, who had open heart surgery very quickly a few weeks ago, he was put back in the hospital yesterday. The area they took the veins from on his leg has gotten infected, and I know he would appreciate your prayers for that also. We have a card in the back that will give you direction if you want to help supply a practical meeting of needs for the Mitchell family, three different ways in which you can do that. It's on the desk. Please pick that up as you go out. People have asked that, and there are some organized ways to do that to make sure we meet those needs in the best way that we can. If you're at Mark chapter 10 today, we've been talking about this time in Jesus' ministry where he moves from ministering to the crowds to the primary ministry of preparing the disciples for Jesus going back to heaven and leaving them in charge of ministry here. Now that, again, that's an astounding thought to me, that the God of the universe left you and me. Look around and you'll find out why. It's a difficult thought that Jesus left us the great privilege and responsibility of the kingdom. He knew something about us that we obviously don't know. That is, when the Spirit of God inhabits you and gives you a new nature, you're in a new economy if you're buying into it. And you can do much more than you ever can imagine if you'll walk in obedience on a day-to-day basis to the Lord. So that's the part of ministry we're in, and it's providential because we're talking right now about going into a very historic year of 2020 and foundational posts that are going to be necessary to do that and navigate that successfully. Pastor Dave spoke on one of those, on the issue of prayer. What an incredible privilege you and I have of accessing and communicating with the God of the universe anytime we want through prayer. Last week, we talked about this perfect wisdom of God and that disciples are missing the teaching lessons Jesus has for them because they're focused on things that they shouldn't be. And here's what they're arguing about, is Jesus is trying to give them principles which will make them successful in carrying out his life's goals for them. They're arguing about who's going to be the greatest. So Jesus turns that on its head and says, if you really want to know what's great in my kingdom, if you really want to know what genuine greatness is, I'm going to tell you. Foundational posts for this next year in navigating life successfully. We find, arguably, it's not even really arguably, it is the greatest foundational post in all of history other than Jesus Christ himself. And that is the issue of family and marriage. And that's what Jesus comes to today as he teaches his disciples. What about children and what about family? And boy, if there's anything that is argued about today, folks, we have people all over the world that are redefining what God says family is. Redefining what God says makes that important and how you do that successfully. And I want to promise you, regardless of what culture tells you and regardless what any expert tells you, God's the one who got it right. God defines it, God created it, and God tells us how to do it successfully. So I want you to notice today, Mark presents the ideal. Let me say that right up front. Mark presents the ideal from the beginning. There are no exception clauses in Mark, not that they don't exist. Matthew has them, and they need to be considered because we live in a fallen world. But you must listen to the heart of God today and recognize how crucial the element of marriage and family and passing on your faith really is. So notice today in Mark chapter 10, 1 through 16, we're going to talk about marriage and family. You know, Jesus was the perfect teacher. He employed many techniques when he communicated truth. Sometimes he spoke in parables and proverbs. Other times he spoke in lengthy exhortations and instruction. In this chapter, we see Jesus employing a method of teaching called a paradox. It's a statement that turns conventional thinking on its head. An example of a paradox is this hypothetical story of the father and son who were in a tragic car accident in which the father was killed. The son, critically injured, was rushed to the hospital where it was determined that surgery would be required. But upon seeing the patient, the surgeon said, "I can't operate on this boy. He's my son. How could this be if the boy's father was killed in the accident?" Well, the obvious answer is the surgeon was the boy's mother. But if you've ever heard that story, you know that. If you haven't, your mind immediately goes to how can that be? A paradox is something that can't seemingly be true, but it is. And we'll see in this chapter before us five such paradoxes. We'll only get to two of them today, but I want you to recognize, and I'll point out the paradoxes, statements that appear to be impossible initially, but Jesus changes our thinking eventually. Please take note of them. This chapter records what is usually called the Perean ministry of Christ. So if you have maps in the back of your Bible, you probably can find this. We're going to put up a map on the screen today of this Perean time of Christ. It's a place that he has not spent much time. Here's Galilee, and Jesus spends most of his time, his hometown area, ministering here on this side of the Jordan. But now we go to the east side of the Jordan, and this is the Perean ministry of Christ. Mark skips a number of months, and he gets to the ministry time where Jesus is in Perea, doing ministry at the end of his life. He points, and Mark, as I said, skips a number of months in chronology to talk about this very important time where Calvary now looms ahead, and Jesus is focusing on primary foundational things to teach to the disciples so that they carry out his ministry and his kingdom successfully in the way that he wants it done. As Calvary looms ahead, its shadowy outline is becoming clearer and clearer every day, like a clear dawn morning as the light rises over the horizon. For you who do hunting, like I have for my entire life, it's one of my favorite times in all of the day when you can't see anything, and 5 minutes later, things begin to open up before you, and it's not long before you see things clearly. I have met a lot of turkeys face to face during that time, and they didn't like the outcome. I did. Met a lot of deer face to face during that time with the bow, and they didn't like the outcome, but I did. But even if I didn't find anything with regard to hunting, I love that time of the morning. And this time in history is a time where Jesus is saying clearly to the disciples, here's what's coming. And I'm telling you clearly, I'm not the kind of Messiah you think I am. I'm not a political Messiah. I'm not a temporary Messiah. I am an eternal Messiah that is going to take care of the issues for the youth of the world, for the more mature of the world, for those outcasts of the world, for those popular in the world. I have the answer, and the answer is coming at Calvary. And he says it clearly. So I want you to notice in that context today, take your Bible and look at Mark chapter 10, verse 1. Then he arose from there and came to the region of Judea by the other side of the Jordan. That's the Perea area I pointed out to you on the map. And multitudes gathered to him again, and as he was accustomed, he taught them again. You see, no matter what Jesus seems to try to do to get alone with the disciples, these crowds keep following him, and he seemingly never tires of teaching. When people came to him or gathered around him, he taught them. I hope this coming year that you will never tire and you will make it an intentional priority to make the feeding of your soul important. That you will give it the priority of time and the priority of the right time in the day where you are most alert and most attuned to what God's going to say to you. Like we do every year, we will have All in the Word this year where we ask you to come and commit that so you can stay accountable to one another. There is nothing, absolutely nothing that can take the place of you spending time in the Word and hearing from God. This body, and God wants us to do life together, but this body is only going to be as strong as those in this body, the links, and making sure that you're doing your part in the body of Christ that God wants you to do, which you are going to be directed through the Holy Spirit by the Word of God. Here's Jesus again teaching the people. And by the way, for those who say that up in the tree stand, which I love to be in, is a place where you can meet God, it's true. But the way that God intends for you as a body to do life is together. And God intends you to be here worshiping together, praying together, growing together. It's essential and it is priority to Jesus. As we see in the messed up temple times where worship was not exactly right and they were doing crazy things, Jesus still, as was his custom, went every single week to that place because that is God's intention in the way that you and I grow. So thank you for being here today and making that the priority that God intends it to be. The two events that we're going to look at today are put so close together, and they give us a picture of God's ideal for the family, the essential sanctity of marriage, and the need for parents to bring their children to Jesus in the context of a Christian home. And Jesus puts them right together intentionally to help us recognize just how important that is. At the time Jesus spoke these words, two schools of thoughts existed among the Jews on the subject of divorce. Very controversial subject then, and the Jews were trying to get Jesus to pick a side so he could divide the audience from one or the other. Yeah, how many of you know it's still a very controversial issue today with regard to Christianity, and what does God really have to say about the issue of divorce? Well, during that time, there were two main rabbinical thoughts. The Rabbi Shammai espoused the narrow view, and that view simply said that the only reason God would give to get a divorce was moral transgression, moral infidelity. Actually, however, in Jewish society, Jewish law allowed divorce on almost any grounds. And the Rabbi Hillel espoused the more liberal view. For example, all true examples and very common, not uncommon examples. A woman could be divorced for spoiling her husband's dinner. And I'm not going to tell you who would be in trouble in here, but I know some who would be. For going outside the house with her head uncovered, for being quarrelsome, for being childless, or even if her husband found some other woman more attractive, she could be divorced. Pharisees doubtless hoped to make the Lord take sides, alienating him, and we know that from verse 2. It says there that they were testing him. Notice where Jesus talks about this permanence of marriage. It says in Mark 10:2, the Pharisees came and asked him, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife? Testing him. One of the versions says tempting him. The word means to put to the test. In other words, they wanted to force Jesus to commit himself to one view or another on this highly controversial issue of divorce. Mark 10, 3 and 4, and he answered and said to them, what did Moses command you? They said, Moses permitted a man to write a certificate of divorce and to dismiss her. The law that they're referring to is found in Deuteronomy 24. A man who discovered something shameful or offensive in his wife could dismiss her from his house with a writ of divorcement. Such grounds of divorce obviously had to be something other than adultery, because if you know in Old Testament law, if a couple was found committing adultery, they were to be stoned. Now, this was offenses other than that. A great deal was left to the discretion of the husband, and the wife had very few rights. Pharisees knew all about the Mosaic law and the body of rabbinical teaching that had developed around it. In fact, it had become so common for divorce to take place in Jesus' day that in order not to clog up the courts, what rabbinical allowed to happen was if a husband wanted to divorce a wife and there were no grounds for a wife to divorce her husband, the husband had all the rights. All the husband had to do is say three times, I divorce you, I divorce you, I divorce you, and it was done. Can you imagine some of those fights? I divorce you. I divorce. No, please. I mean, you talk about a horrible, scary way to have to live, because once a woman is divorced, she is helpless and hopeless in that culture. You know, one of the things I hear talked about often in this culture is the way that Christianity puts down women. I want to tell you, folks, it's a lie. It always has been. It always will be. Jesus has always elevated the status of women to that of equality with men. Galatians 3:28 says that. Now, we have different functions and roles. I can't have a baby, don't want to. God gave that privilege to my wife. Different functions and roles, but God said we are equal in Christ. And Jesus said something rather astounding here. He said if a man divorces his wife or a woman divorces her husband, and they're going, wait a minute, women can't divorce their husband. He elevates this status of women as God's equal created being. So when someone says to you that Paul is a chauvinist or Peter is a and we have to understand culture when it comes into it with the way that God wants us to respond in roles. I want you to notice Jesus throws that argument on its head here today. They're trying to get Jesus to make a decision on this issue of divorce. And where does Jesus take them? He sidesteps the whole issue and he takes them to the beginning. The way that God created us. The way that God intended it to be from the beginning. Has nothing to do with culture. Has nothing to do with where you grow up. This is the way God said he made it to be. And this is the ideal. So, I want you to notice, and I want you to remember today, that God put us together in families to supplement and complement each other in with regard to love and harmony. Look at Mark 10:6. Mark 10:6. Or go to Mark 10:5. And Jesus answered and said to them, because of the hardness of your heart, Moses wrote this precept. Anytime divorce comes into the picture, Jesus says it's either one or both, but there is an issue of hardness of the heart. We call it all kinds of things today. We call it incompatibility, because of all kinds of things. Jesus says the issue is hardness of the heart. Say, what does Jesus mean about that? Here's what Jesus means. Here's what I'm going to answer before God one day. God is going to put me before him and say, did you love Tammy as Christ loved the church? That's your responsibility as a husband. And I want to remind all of us husbands in here, Christ loved us regardless, right? He loved us while we were yet sinners. He loves us with unconditional love regardless of how we as the body respond to him. It's a one-sided love, agape love. It can be kept alive one-sided. And you are the responsible party, husband, to be the leader in that. Amen or oh me. That's what God says. Gets real quiet when we talk about this, because this is impossible stuff unless you are led by God and recognize that when I am loving Tammy, I am essentially loving Christ. I am looking back past her and saying, Christ is the one I am loving if I am loving Tammy as Christ loved the church. And on the converse of that, when I do not love my wife that way, I am not loving Christ. That's the principle of marriage. Now that's tough stuff, it is, but let me remind you, ladies, what God says your responsibility to do, regardless of how your husband is acting, is to respect him as unto the Lord. If you are showing him respect, you are in essence respecting Christ, who is deserving always of full respect. And when you don't, you are not respecting Christ. So Christian marriages are based on more than feeling and the wonderful thing of growing together. They are based on this mystery, Ephesians 5 says, of a picture of Christ in the church. And that is the very foundational block of all of society if we're going to have God bless society. That is the context of raising children in the fear and admonition of the Lord. Because of the hardness of your heart, Moses gave these exception clauses, because sometimes in the messiness of life and the imperfections of life, divorce happens. But it was not God's intent. Mark 10:6. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. Adam's paradise was not complete. In fact, Hebrews, a very expressive language at that point, when God creates woman and Adam's not complete, he says, wow. And he's complete. You've created woman, and that has completed me as a man. This great concept of male and female, equal, different roles in God's sight, doing life together. In fact, I have a friend who's preaching through Mark right now, and I didn't even know it, and that's what he's calling Mark, doing life together, because it's important. You're not to live in relationship apart from doing it together in the context of a Christian home biologically, in the context of a forever family. The truth is, there have always been people who do not do that ideally. And you know who they are? Look at the person next to you. That person's not doing it ideally. And then get out a mirror and look in the mirror. That person's not doing it ideally ever. But thank God he can grow us. And he gives us the capacity to grow in him and to do it better. And those that grow up in that capacity, just if you were here yesterday, you saw an example of that. 8 precious children that are without a mama, but looking with realistic pain and challenges to a God who promised them he knows what's going on and he'll take care of them. That doesn't happen by accident. That happens because people input their life. So here's the challenge for all of us in here. There's people who don't have that and they've messed up or other things have happened and they need you as a Christian family to step in and supplement and help them see that and change the direction, because marriage and family is God's intent and it's his ideal. And thank God for the grace he gives for the unideal in all of us, but we can help each other grow in that. And Jesus says, let's go back to the beginning. From the beginning, God made them male and female. Mark 10:7-9. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So then they are no longer two, but one. That's the first paradox. Write it down. Note it. Circle it in your scripture. Two become one. How in the world is that possible? The paradox. Two become one. Husband and wife no longer are two, they are one. So when you get in that big hairy fight, maybe you had one on the way to church. I always laughed about couples that were in my class. I came to know them very well. And we'd talk about this and they'd say, we were one of them today. And you get out of church and say, oh, praise God, isn't this the day that the Lord has made and all that. And you had this hairy fight. I just remind you, when you do that, when you are whacking your wife or you're whacking your husband, you're whacking yourself. It's not who's right or wrong. It's working it out and becoming all that God wants you to be. To become one. In the marriage ceremony, when a man and a woman stand before the Father, when prayer is offered for their relationship and blessing pronounced upon their marriage, the two of them become one in the eyes of God the Father. The Lord was precise in his choice of words here. The word for leave is a very strong Hebrew word. It's a very strong Greek word in this passage. It means to leave behind, to depart from, to forsake. How many know there's still real challenges in some marriages because that never happens? A daughter never leaves her mom and dad emotionally, or a husband stays so connected to his parents that there is never that real leaving and that real loyalty. And God said it's got to happen in marriage. The word cleave literally means to glue or to cement. So you are to leave behind your previous relationships and to glue or cement yourself to this marriage relationship, so much so that the two become one in God's eyes. Mark 10:9. Therefore, what God has joined together, let not man separate. Circle it, underline it, star it. When a couple nowadays begins to talk about the possibility of divorce, they do not begin here. But I want to remind you, this is where God says we as believers are supposed to park. The ideal, Mark 10:9, what God has joined together, let not man separate. God says these vows are sacred and strong and not to be easily set aside. Indeed, from the divine point of view, no man or woman has any right to break apart a marriage once God has welded the two into one. Only great pain and loss and wreckage and ruin can result from tearing asunder what God has put together. That is God's ideal. I'm not telling you that because I don't recognize many people have the pain of divorce. And Matthew acknowledges that, the fallenness of man and the challenge and the what we call in our vernacular the exception clauses. But I want to tell you, Mark doesn't. Mark just takes us right to the ideal and says, here's God's ideal, and shoot for the ideal. And if you mess up, and we do every day, just because you're married doesn't mean you're doing it right. How many of you know that? If you don't, ask your spouse. They'll tell you. You don't always do it right. We don't do it perfectly. We do it imperfectly, and we cause pain. But God says the way that you're going to have a faith that makes it is take God at His word and do it God's way. And the ideal is the two become one, and they have these wonderful, precious children many times, and that is the context in which children thrive. And don't offend them. It's better for a millstone to be tied around your neck than you offend one of these little ones. So you say, well, Pastor, are you saying that you should do your absolute best to always stay married? Yes. So, well, Pastor, have you ever counseled anyone to get a divorce? No. Pastor, do you believe that there are exception clauses in Scripture? Absolutely are, but God's ideal, God's best, is to apply grace and to do the very best you can. You say, well, what if your partner won't have anything to do with that? You stand accountable before God for doing your utmost best, because ultimately you are serving Christ, not your partner. How many of you know that takes real work? Would you say amen? Don't poke your partner. How many of you know that takes real work, right? How many of you know that takes a real thing called forgiveness? And by the way, may I remind you this? If you think that forgiveness is a tough thing, have you ever thought of this? It takes God's willingness to forgive you. He's perfect. He forgives you debt which makes possible relationship with you. Why do we think it's not going to take forgiveness with two imperfect people? And yet many people go through this pain, the reality and the searing pain of divorce. And it's why I'm so thankful for the grace of God and the forever family that God gives. Because you know what God wants, and some of you do this so beautifully, God wants you to step into those families and show those families the ideal and turn that situation around where that boy or that girl or that husband or that wife who has a shattered and broken heart regains hope and perspective. And God gives you the capacity to do that. Some of you have had death, and you know how painful that is. Some of you have had divorce, you know how painful that is. But folks, as a forever family, God gives grace in imperfect situations. If He didn't, we'd all be in trouble. And He asks you and me to step in and supplement that. Are you doing that, and are you aware? I'm so grateful. Every single year, we get to have people that are alone or displaced or challenged, we're just in need of love at our home for Christmas. Now, all of us are in need of that. But there's always people out there. And I'm thankful for the ministry that God gives those of us whom He has showered abundant grace on to be able to help people that have gone through much more difficult things. And folks, I want to tell you something. I don't take for granted, well, you just know the Bible better so your marriage stays together. Folks, how many of you know it's but by the grace of God marriage stays together? Amen? How many of you know you can do it? I have people who have raised their children wonderfully, and their children have made the decision to walk away from the things of the Lord. Now, the good news is 90% of them by stats come back, but it's painful. I make no judgment on people. Well, that person's better and they did that. No, thank God for His grace, and we need to reach out and minister to one another. But we cannot, in the midst of ministry, turn our eyes and our deaf ears to the fact that God says the permanence of marriage is incredibly important in a society that's going to be God-pleasing. We got to be committed to it. We got to teach our children the importance of that. I'm thankful. My parents have been married almost 60 years. Tammy's parents married almost 60 years. We will have our 40th year anniversary this year if both of us stay alive. Because we made a commitment a long time ago. We're going to have a good marriage or a bad marriage, but we're going to have a marriage. You say, well, how can you know that? Because that's our commitment to the Lord. It's not about Tammy. It's not about me. It's about our commitment to the Lord. And God cares about that. And we decided we're going to work on having a good marriage. Why be miserable around each other in this thing that God says is wonderful? But it takes work. So God says here, with regard to marriage, it is a permanent deal. Two become one. Don't let what God's put together be separated. Mark 10:10-12, in the house, his disciples also ask him again about the same matter. He said to them, why ask him? Because he turned it on its head. He not only said men could divorce women, he said if women divorce men, and his disciples couldn't get their arms around it. Jesus, did you really say that? And he says the same thing. Whoever divorces his wife, marries another, commits adultery. And if a woman divorces her husband, that didn't make any sense. It didn't happen. If a woman divorces her husband, marries another, she commits adultery. Radical statement in the ears of the disciples. Again, Jesus clearly placing women on the same level as men. Equality, Galatians 3:28. Surely wasn't true in the Roman culture or the Grecian culture, or even the Christian culture at that time, but Jesus says it's true to me nonetheless. So the disciples ask him the same thing, and Jesus' answer is the same. Mark records God's ideal, this view of permanence and perfection and purity in marriage. One of the reasons of this, God's insistence on the permanence of marriage, is because of the preciousness of children. God loves children, which are supposed to be raised in loving, godly homes that portray a continual picture of Christ in the church. And divorce can really mess with the ones that God loves. In fact, if you know anything about it, many times children blame themselves, even when husbands and wives are very, very careful to say it's not your fault. God gives grace and people can work through that. But folks, I want to tell you, your marriage is worth saving. God's grace is real. God's grace will sustain. I could give you story after story of God's redemption in marriage. I'm going to bring Tony and Joy Busick into here sometime and just let you hear their story. No one would ever believe they got a divorce, but they did. No one would ever believe the challenges they went through, but they were real. But they have four precious children now that are serving God, and Tony is a pastor that God is using, and Joy is an incredibly gifted musician who walks right beside her husband, and they got remarried, and God did a wonderful picture of grace, and he's capable and willing to do that in your life. Notice not only the permanence of marriage, but the preciousness of children, Mark 10:13. Then they brought the little children that he might touch them, but the disciples rebuked those who brought them. It's a masculine in the Greek, but it's used generally, so probably both parents it applies to. The disciples have a tendency to do this kind of thing. If it's not their idea, they tend to exclude people who didn't belong to their group, and somehow they think it's their job to exclude people that Jesus created from getting to Jesus. The verb they brought is an imperfect. It means they brought and they kept on bringing. The disciples were not very successful in keeping parents from bringing their kids to Jesus. They recognized the importance of it and they just kept on bringing them. I'll never forget the day that Dr. Falwell died my whole life. It was a surreal day. I happened to be over at the hospital visiting someone, and I was in the emergency room, and here came in Jonathan and Jerry, and I knew something was wrong and Dr. Falwell had died. We went home and we told Jaden, and she was little. And she immediately burst out in tears. See, Dr. Falwell, at his core, said, I'm a youth pastor, always have been. God loves children. And God's given me a heart for children. And Jaden, without any thought, would run up to one of the busiest men in America and lift her arms, and immediately Dr. Falwell would scoop her up in his arms, put her in his lap, and hug her and kiss on her. And she felt loved by Jerry Falwell. She could get to him when a lot of other people couldn't. Just a kid running up. Listen, folks. That's how God wants you to be with him. Abba, Father. We try to explain so many things when we get adults in our mind. You see, children, the Bible says we're supposed to have childlike faith, not childish faith. How many know the difference between being childish and childlike? Raise your hand. Childlike is baby. You're acting like a baby when you're an adult. That's not a good quality. But childlike faith is simply putting your trust and your weight on God, not understanding how it's all going to work out, but knowing He is trustworthy and hopping up into the lap of Abba Father and saying, God, I'm here. I need your grace. I need your strength. And God says children need that, and they need that modeled in home. My children wondered a lot of things. I don't think they ever wondered if they came home and looked in the refrigerator if food was going to be there. They just trusted that. Scares me to think, but it's just absolutely true. Every one of my kids, I'd go in the front yard except Jaden because I was a little wiser by then, I hope. Still threw her up, but I didn't throw her like I did my first kids, man. I threw them as high as I possibly could. Again and again and again and again till they get winded, because you know what every one of them say? Do it again, Daddy. Do it again, Daddy. Do it again, Daddy. And I didn't just throw them up. I'd flip them, man. We do double turns sometimes. I mean, we were doing all kinds of stuff. And I think about it. I was in Virginia where there's not level ground. All it would take is just one of those times, me dropping. It scares me to death. But you know what? They trusted me. Not really trustworthy to do that, but guess who is? The God of the universe. And you know what He says to you? Be like a child who I love. And put yourself in my trust and my care and pass that down to the children who I care about. So much so, if a millstone, it's better for a millstone to be hung around your neck than you offend one of these ones. Notice what He says in verse 14. But when Jesus saw it, He was greatly displeased, and He said to them, let the little children come to me. Don't forbid them, for such is the kingdom of God. Hey, you don't understand my heart like you think you do. You've got it all wrong. Those kids are my heart. That's childlike faith is what makes up the kingdom. Statistics gathered over many years show that children, 90% of people get saved before they're 12 years of age now. The age just keeps going down. That's worldwide. They still have the capacity to trust. They still have the capacity to not have to have understand everything logically, but put themselves in the place of a God who loves them and simply say, I trust you, God. I'm putting myself into your hands. Jochebed's a perfect example of this powerful Christian home. You remember Moses, and he's born into a time where Hebrew babies are supposed to be killed, and his mama builds this little miniature ark and puts him out there. And in providence of God, the daughter of Pharaoh finds him, gives him back to mama to raise him. And Jochebed's mom raised her son in the fear and admonition of the Lord so powerfully that nothing in Egypt, being a prince of Egypt, could not tear his heart away from Jehovah God. That's what God asks you to do. It's what God asks me to do. Look at verse 15. And by the way, again, it's very significant that this incident of the children immediately follows the teaching of divorce. Jesus is saying the family must be protected at all costs. You can't let anything come in and destroy our children. Verse 15, assuredly I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will by no means enter it. And he took them up in his arms and he put his hands on them and he blessed them. Little 9-year-old last night, about where Hewitt's sitting, on this side You want to accept Jesus. Okay, thank you. I said it again. Anybody else? Here goes her hands up again. You really want to come to a sense of the claims of Christ in your life and you want to accept Jesus. I said, young lady, I've seen your hand. She comes out there and tells me, you know what? Childlike faith is how you enter the kingdom. In the context of the way that that happens, Boast, is in the context of a Christian home. So I'm going to ask you this morning to do something. Entering this very historic year of 2020, you see, when parents came to Jesus, they were not sent away empty. One after another, they put their children into Jesus' arms, and it says he blessed them. I don't know what you want for Christmas, but if I had one thing that I could choose, it would be that God would supernaturally bless my family. So I'm going to ask you to do this. Danny's going to come and he's going to play a song. It's a song about family and the power of family. Here's what I'm going to ask you to do. I'm going to ask you to gather together up around here and down the aisles in family units. Right now, our children, which Ben Yates and a number of our faithful people minister to every single week, and they teach our children the things about Jesus, important foundational principles about Jesus. And I'm thankful for that. But they are supposed to be a supplement, right? They're not supposed to be the primary. They're supposed to be supplementing what we teach in our home. So as this song goes on, they're going to come and they're going to stand across here. If you are part of that family unit, say, I'm just an uncle or aunt. No, you're not just an uncle or aunt. You don't have kids of your own. You gather to that family unit. I'm grandma and grandpa, an important part of that family unit. I am great grandma and grandpa. You're an important part of that family unit. If we have children here today that came with other families, I'm going to ask those children to gather with those families or gather with Miss Tammy, because we're going to pray for everybody. But as our children come in today during this song, I'm just going to ask you to gather with them. Now, if you have children in our nursery right next door and you want to join, to have them join you during this song, please go out and get them. And we're going to have a time of prayer together at the end of this song, committing our families to the principles of the Lord. So as we do this, if you're going to go to the nursery, go ahead and do that now and join your families up front. Brother Danny.
So come and fill our homes with your presence. You alone are worthy of our reverence. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. We will serve the Lord.
As you come in, children, if you would spread out a little bit, because your families are going to be joining you. So give some room in between. And you guys grab whoever it is and find your spot. Thank you. Go ahead.
Lord, we vow to live holy, bowing our knees to you only. As for me and my house, we will serve. Staying together, fathers and mothers, sisters and brothers, in harmony. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. We will serve the Lord.
All right, Ben Yates. Would you come and stand right here, and everybody who helped this week, would you come and stand across here? I just want you to notice the commitment of so many in this church body to help teach your children foundational truths. So would you join Ben, if you were here helping this week, across the front here? Ben, where are the rest of your folks? All right, if you would come and join him real quick, I'm going to let you go back to your family. So if you were here this week and you helped, Ben, if you would raise your hand, some people in here may not know you, would you give all of our help a hand for what they do in helping raise our children? Please take the time to thank them. It's an incredibly important foundational part of life. If you are here and you are a child without your mom and dad and you're not with a family, where are you, Miss Tammy? Miss Tammy is right here, so please join Miss Tammy so she can pray with you. And here's what I'm going to ask you to do. As a family unit, is everybody together? Is anybody still trying to get to a certain place? Because if you are, we can spread out more. Okay, so here's one more thing I'm going to ask you to do. If you're closely connected to one of these families, and you want them to know, and you can't do it with everyone, I understand that, but if you're closely connected with one of them, and you want them to know that you're going to be praying for them in an intentional way in 2020, would you quickly come and join that family? So spread out a little more so people can come. Just go up that way, Clayton, up that aisle some, and go up that way a little. And you, Billy, if you'll take people up that aisle a little bit so we can have a little more room. You want to come and join them? Then come join them right now. Just say, excuse me. If you're here as a guest, you want to join this, obviously, incredibly important, you feel free to do that. Here's what I'm going to ask you to do. Would you, if the father is present in your family unit, Father, I'm going to ask you right now to commit your family, your mom and dad or your wife's parents and whatever, and the rest of your family to Christ this year. If not, I'm going to ask the mama to do that. If that's not available, then I'm going to ask a grandparent to do that. But would you commit your family unit to Christ and ask Christ to be central and ask Christ to help all of you raise your children in the fear and admonition of the Lord? We're going to do that for a minute or two, so be very specific. Would you take the time and do that right now, please? Dear Heavenly Father, every single one of us in here are part of a family unit. It has some wonderful parts and it also has some challenging parts. But I pray in this coming year of 2020 that you will help us to live out your ideal. Help us fathers love our wives as Christ loved the church. Help wives to love their husbands as unto the Lord. And Lord, we're so grateful in those areas where we mess up, and all of us do, Some in here have come from incredibly broken situations with divorce and some with deaths of spouses and things that really hurt. We're thankful for your grace, and I pray that as the only one who can make a crooked stick straight, Lord, help us all to be sensitive to one another and help supplement one another and point us to Christ. And intercede in our children's lives and bring grace to them and help them do it much better than we ever have. Help them to portray Christ in the church and the marriages that are to come if you give us that time. But I pray that 2020 will be a real year of families becoming more like you, of our lives individually reflecting Christ in the church in the way that you intend us to, of living in the power of Christ. We're incapable of living this way alone. We are incapable of forgiving. But through your new nature, we can, and it sets us free. We're incapable of loving the way you've asked us to, and that we know you are love, and you command us to love, and give us the grace to do that through your power. So I pray for every single family in here, the ones seated as well as the ones up front, that all of us would take seriously the privilege we have of serving you in this coming new year. Bless our families and help us to be a blessing in our biological family and in our forever family. In Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people said, thank you, folks. Give each other a hug and go find your seat. Keep your kids with you. Keep your kids that you got from the nursery with you so we don't cause chaos over there. And please be seated if you can do that. A lot of people hugging is good stuff. Here's what I want to ask you to do as people find their ways to their seat. I'm not going to extend the invitation long this morning. But if you are here today and you know God wants you to be part of this family, then say excuse me and wait, make your way down front. I don't want to preclude people who know that God wants them to do that. So if you're up here already and you know that, just let us know. Pastor Kevin's up here. Pastor Dave is up here. Hey, God wants me to be part of this family. Secondly, as Christians still pray, would you pray for anybody in here that does not know Jesus? If you're in here today without Christ as your Savior, here's the good news. Jesus said, whosoever will may come. You turn from your sin and self and say yes to Jesus, you can have that new nature. So I'm going to ask you to bow your heads as you go back to your seats. We're not going to prolong the invitation, but if God has spoken to you today on the first verse of this invitation, would you respond in obedience to the Lord and come and respond to what God has said as we sing together?
Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Would you bow your head? Would you pray as a congregation for this forever family? God wants to do amazing things in our lives this coming year. You pray for the people around you and pray for one another that God would have His way and we would be submissive and tender to the things of the Lord. Secondly, would you pray for the program tonight that God would bring people out, people that do not know Christ, and they'd walk out of here knowing Christ, and those of us that do, that God would use it in our lives to make us more effective, greater worshipers of Him. Lord, we thank you for that. Thank you for the privilege we've had of talking about the way that you intended to make us successful. And we know today, Lord, it's a great challenge because we mess it up on a daily basis, sometimes more often than that. But I thank you for your grace, and I thank you for your forgiveness, and I thank you for your power, which gives us the capacity to do it the way you've asked us to. So may we own the responsibility and privilege we have of being all that you called us to be. And may we do that in greater ways, displaying your glory, this mystery of Christ in the church, this incredible privilege of raising up children in the fear and admonition of the Lord. Help us to do that in greater ways in 2020. Look forward to seeing what you're going to do tonight. We look forward to worshiping you during this Christmas season. Thank you that Tammy and I get to do that together with this wonderful body that we love. Thank you for our forever family. We look forward to celebrating your birth together in a brand new year this year. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. See you guests at the back. God bless you. See you tonight at 6.